There's a set time for your miracle, and you are closer than you even think. Welcome, welcome, welcome. I'm Donna Shambach, and you are tuned in to Power Connection. We welcome all of our regular viewers and listeners by podcast, and we welcome those of you who may be watching for the very first time. I make no apology. We believe in miracles. Our church building is called Miracle Chapel. Every month we have a miracle night, and when I travel, I love to believe God for outstanding miracles. But you know, every once in a while, we need a breakthrough miracle, something that is going to set us up for the future that God has intended for us. And I believe that those types of miracles, God works out in a process. And today I want to begin a series that I'm entitling How Miracles Begin. And I believe there's truth for any miracle that we believe in, but particularly if you are trusting God for your children and grandchildren or for your ministry or for something that you know that God has promised you but you haven't quite seen it yet, I want to set you up so that you know the pathway. You know what God will use to help you find that miracle. Today I'm talking from Joshua, and I want to just start out by saying this. You may be closer to that miracle than you think. There might just be one thing, one adjustment that you can make into your relationship with God, the way that you pray, one adjustment that will get you over the threshold so that you can see that miracle. Joshua chapter 5, verse 1, God was getting ready to take the second generation of Israelites into the promised land. If you will remember, Moses was already dead, the great leader that had brought them out of Egypt. Their parents had perished in the wilderness. They were not permitted to go into the promised land because of their unbelief. But now there's a new generation, and God has handpicked them to take territory and to push out all of the pagan people from their land. So Joshua chapter 5, verse 1 says, "When all the Amorite kings west of the Jordan and all the Canaanite kings who lived along the Mediterranean coast heard how the Lord had dried up the Jordan River so the people of Israel could cross, they lost heart and were paralyzed with fear because of them." I want you to think about this. Sometimes the enemy knows the power of God in your life in a greater capacity than you know it yourself. These Israelites, they had their own fears. They didn't know what to expect when they would cross over to possess the land. They only had a word to walk on. They only had to trust God and obey His commandments. But they had no idea that the enemy's hearts were filled with fear because the enemy had seen the hand of God in their lives. This is what I want to encourage you with today. You may feel as though you're not making any progress, or all you feel is the resistance of the enemy. But I want you to know that enemy fears the God in you. He fears the anointing on your life. And so you can take heart today that you are closer to that miracle than you thought. God has a set time to bring it to place, and you are His set person. You've got to own that and believe that, that what He's told you He will do, He's chosen you to see it through. He's given you a set purpose, just like the Israelites. But I want to continue to read, because in order for God to fully put things into motion for His chosen people, He had to get those chosen people into the place where they would hear his voice and obey him immediately and obey him precisely. In their life, there was no room for fear. There was no room for compromise. And there certainly wasn't any room for disobedience. Let's keep reading. Joshua chapter 1, this time, verses 2 to 11. This is the beginning place that God had this generation. It says, at that time, the Lord told Joshua, make flint knives and circumcise the second generation of Israelites. So Joshua made flint knives and circumcised the entire male population of Israel, of Gibeath Haraloth. Joshua had to circumcise them because all the men who were old enough to fight in the battle when they left Egypt had died in the wilderness. Those who left Egypt had all been circumcised, but none of these born after the Exodus during the years in the wilderness had been circumcised. The Israelites had traveled in the wilderness for 40 years until all the men who were old enough to fight in battle when they left Egypt had died. For they had disobeyed the Lord. And the Lord vowed he would not let them enter the land he had sworn to give them, a land flowing with milk and honey. So Joshua circumcised their sons, those who had grown up to take their father's places, for they had not been circumcised on the way to the promised land. I want you to think about that. Before they were able to experience this generational miracle, this transition, this miracle that's going to take them before giants and enemies that they did not have the natural power to resist, before they would see the glory of God come against their enemies, there was something that God required. And it was circumcision. Circumcision, obviously, we know that is when the knife is taken to the most sensitive part of the man's body to cut away the foreskin. In other words, God is saying everything that flows from you from here on out, all of your generations, I want it to be marked by covenant that you belong to me, your children belong to me, your grandchildren. You are in covenant relationship with me from generation to generation. It's a serious thing. We cannot enter into a relationship with God and just say, hey, I need a miracle, God, and then go about our lives as though he doesn't even exist, that he's not speaking to us or requiring something of us. And so this is the circumcision. This is a symbol of true consecration. You know, we have a generation that has a lot of stories from the past of the outpouring of the glory of God and healing and miracle revivals and revivals that lasted for 5 years or 10 years and then were no longer. But there were great moves of God in this nation. But in recent days, we have seen a great falling away from the church. There are people who have been burnt out on religion, those that have been disappointed in the church, and they have put that disappointment on God. They don't read their Bibles. They don't even know what the Bible says. They may want a miracle. They may want a slap on the head. They may even send into the message box, please pray for me. But they haven't had time to sit before God and say, Lord, examine my heart. Is there anything that needs to be cut away from me so that I can have your power flowing through me? I want to renew my covenant with you, God. Romans chapter 2, verses 28 and 29 says this, for you are not a true Jew just because you were born of Jewish parents or because you have gone through the ceremony of circumcision. No, and I want you to hear this, a true Jew is one whose heart is right with God. And true circumcision is not nearly obeying the letter of the law. Rather, it is a change of heart produced by the Spirit. And a person with a changed heart seeks praise from God and not from people. Now, this is the New Covenant understanding of circumcision. Circumcision of the heart, done by the Spirit of God. But it's a work of grace that cuts away the desires of the flesh, the going after praise of man, all of the things that can get in the way of us fulfilling our purpose here on earth. God wants you to have a circumcision of the heart. In John chapter 15, Jesus was talking to his disciples. It was one of the last discourses he had with them before he was taken away. And this is what it says in verse 1 and 2. He said, I am the true vine, or the grapevine, as this translation says, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off, does that sound familiar? He cuts off every branch of mine that doesn't produce fruit, and he prunes the branches that do bear fruit so they will produce even more. You see, this is a theme that comes to us throughout Scripture, that there has to be a cutting away of the dead, the things that aren't producing any godliness in our life. And there has to come a cutting away of those hindrances that keep us from growing any further. I just had this happen in my own backyard. I got some beautiful new trees that are flowering, but there's been some shoots that have come up on the bottom, and the gardener had to go in and just cut those off so that the flowers can come forth with more fullness. There could be greater fruit on those trees. And this is what God wants for us. He doesn't want us sapped in our spiritual strength from distractions and hindrances and the cares of this world. No, he wants us pruned. He wants us laying aside every weight. He wants us to be ready to run, because in this generation, we need to bear fruit that remains. There are those that are on their way to hell. They've never given their hearts to Jesus Christ. Some don't even know his name. There's a generation that's filled with atheism in their hearts. They don't know that God produces miracles. And if we want to see those miracles come forth from our life, we're going to have a consecrated heart. We're going to have a circumcision of the heart. Can I put it this way? We need to be all in. Everything that I am belongs to the Lord. I'm in covenant relationship with him. Now, as we go on in the weeks that come, we're going to see how God wrought many miracles in this generation that had not been circumcised. But right before they entered that promised land, God required it of them, and they obeyed. Let's pray right now. Father, I thank you so much for those that are listening today. Lord, I know that you have great purpose planned for them. You have handpicked them, Lord, to bear fruit unto your name. And God, if you are calling them to a new place of consecration and prayer and humility before you, I ask you by the power of the Holy Spirit, you would just turn the searchlight on their hearts. Let them see anything that's become a hindrance or a weight or a distraction, Lord. And I ask you by the power of the Holy Spirit, as they submit to you and obey you, just like those children of Israel going into the promised land, I ask you, Lord, that this will be a fresh season. This will be a fresh time of obedience. And this will be the greatest year of harvest they have ever seen in their life. I thank you for it, Lord, in Jesus' name. And Lord, for the one who's never received you as Lord and Savior, and they know by what they see in the world, they need to have a relationship with you. I pray as they call out to you, Lord Jesus, and repent of their sins, that you would make yourself known to them in a powerful and a real way. in Jesus' mighty name. If you prayed to receive Jesus Christ as Savior, just go to our website. You can see it right there on the screen. And I want you to let us know that you prayed to receive Jesus today. We want to stay in touch with you. And so, until next time, check out our website, check out our School of Ministry, check out all the things that God is doing through us. We love the fact that many of you are partnering with us. If you've never sent in an offering to Shambach Ministries and you'd like to be part of what we're doing worldwide, I invite you to do that. God has given us some blessed partners, and they stay blessed because they invest in souls. Amen. This is Donna Shambach and Power Connection. We'll see you next week.
Hey everybody, this is Quest Gatlin, Director of Operations at Shambach Ministries, and I just wanted to say thank you for joining us today, and wanted to encourage you to subscribe to our YouTube channel so you don't miss a thing. You can also follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. For more information about upcoming events, Shambach School of Ministry, and how you can be a part of our worldwide outreach, go to shambach.org or donnaglobal.com. See you next time on Power Connection.